So, hello everyone, welcome to this talk that will be about full-time open source. And let me introduce myself. So, my name is Fridolin. You can find me under Fridex nickname on Twitter, GitHub, and all the social media. I contributed to open source first time back in 2011. That was into GNU Hurd. And then I started, after some time, coding professionally open source in 2013 when I joined Red Hat. Something about me, I like Linux, C, C++. Most of the time I code in Python. That's also the language I like and prefer. I do road cycling. I'm interested in psychology and philosophy. And I used to be a goalkeeper, but now I'm a keeper of few open source projects on GitHub. So we will talk about two main topics. The first one is open source culture and my employee, that is Red Hat. And I will slightly talk about the culture and how it influences open source projects that are born at Red Hat. And that will be the second part of the presentation. Okay, so Red Hat, this is the logo. It's not factory for Red Hat. This was older logo. I prefer it more. It's Shadow Man, and it was cool because there was a dinosaur hidden. Okay, so Red Hat, if you take a look at culture and you click on about Red Hat and the core business values. Red Hat is powered by open source, open culture, and you really feel that in the organization. If you go to TED Talk and you watch TED Talk by Jim Whitehurst, who is ex-CEO of Red Hat, where he explains how the culture is different and how it influenced him when he came to Red Hat. I think previously he was the CEO of Delta Airlines or something like that. There's also a book that is The Open Organization. If you are a Red Hatter, you receive one. And Red Hat is known to have a flat org chart. So I think the depth is something like 8 managers maximum. So it's not that common manager of manager is CTO, for example. And as Red Hat does open source, we support Hacktoberfest, and many of our repositories have Hacktoberfest, and we were also happy to see contributors to these Hacktoberfest repositories. Red Hat is mostly known about Red Hat Enterprise Linux, that is an enterprise distribution of a Linux operating system, but there is also Fedora, that is a community distribution, and Red Hat does development, so there are other projects like OpenStack, OpenShift, and many others. If you are a Red Hatter, you will receive a Red Hat or Red Fedora, and that's how it looks like. So people sometimes, especially on team buildings, wear Red Hat. As of now, I work in a team that is called AI Center of Excellence, AICOE. It's in the office of the CTO. And our goal is to apply emerging technologies to products at Red Hat, but also research new possibilities and find a way where to apply AI or machine learning. Red Hat is a global organization, so it's common you have colleagues from all around the world, and it's a multicultural environment. So imagine you have colleagues from Czech Republic, US, Brazil, Australia, and try to schedule a meeting with them. That's something good. I spent more than 7 years at Red Hat and been in 5 teams. Most of the time, you really look for work, so you need to be somehow open-minded and do something you love. Your voice is really visible in the company. So if you are an intern, it doesn't matter. You can still have big words to senior principals and stuff like that. So it's really open. Now let's talk about open source projects. All these open source projects are on GitHub. I cherry picked few. I worked on most of them. And feel free to contribute. Most of them have community and are used in different companies. And that's also nice. So if you work on an open source project and someone opens a pull request, that's really like you feel that your time is worth spent. And as you will see, these open source projects have global impact. So one of the open source projects that had large impact was a Linux kernel TLS DTLS module. So it started at Red Hat, where we developed a kernel module that did optimized TLS and DTLS connections. And then suddenly another company, that is Facebook, started cooperating with us and pushed sources to vanilla Linux kernel. So as of now, this kernel module is used at Facebook or other companies. And if you browse, for example, videos or pictures on Facebook, probably it's used to serve static content. So you really can influence how things work globally. Another project, that's Project Tot. The name is somehow complicated, and as I said, Red Hat is a multicultural environment, so it was quite often hard to pronounce it. So if you have a colleague from Germany and someone connects from England and you say Project Tot, there are funny stories to tell. The project itself is a larger deployment into a cluster. It's available on GitHub, so you can browse all the sources. You can see how it is written, how it is deployed. You can browse documentation. And one of the main offerings of that project is a Python Cloud Resolver that we will talk about. The Resolver is based on reinforcement learning, and it's like enhancing how Python applications could be served and the dependencies of these applications could be managed. We aggregate data about open source projects that are subsequently used in this resolver. Again, data are open source, so anyone can contribute, anyone can see what's happening and how things work under the hood. So if you're interested, you can also browse the implementation. The resolver is implemented in a component that is called Advisor. So briefly speaking about the project, imagine you are coding a Python application. So most of the time, people use pip or pipenv, poetry, all these tools for managing dependencies. This is more like drop-in replacement for these tools. So if you are running an application, what you can do, you can install a command line interface that is called Tamos, and then configure. Let Tamos configure your environment, and instead of running pip install your libraries, you call Tamos advise, and that's the command that triggers resolution in the Cloud Resolver. So the tool aggregates information about your environment, what's your application, sends that information to the cloud, and cloud gives you back a log file with all the libraries that you can use. As I said, the resolver uses aggregated knowledge about dependencies. So if you're coding, you probably know that dependency help when you install some dependencies and they don't work well together, there are issues. And this is an example when Pillow, one library in specific version, did not work with NumPy. And that caused the following runtime error. It was reported after both libraries were released. So if you are a developer and you don't know about this issue, then you need to Google it, you need to find a resolution for that issue, and you need to somehow spend time fixing not your code and you do not develop your application. That's what's expected from you. So the Cloud Resolver accepts data that are in the following form. Basically, it's a YAML file that states in a machine-readable form that Pillow in that version does not work with NumPy. And when the resolution finds and spots these two libraries, it automatically says that the given resolution is not acceptable and finds another resolution path. That also means that you are notified about that fact, and the resolver will give you back in about that. So, as I stated, the whole project is open source. There are open data, so anyone can contribute and write these recipes for the resolver in the form of prescriptions. Also, the deployment is open source. You can see how the application is deployed. What we do, we also do open tech talks. So if you're interested in how the application is developed, what issues we are tackling, we have a YouTube channel where we post information and recordings from our Scrum meetings and architectural decisions meetings. And also, if you want to use the resolver, you can do so. Just visit .station.ninja and you can find documentation on that project. So that was another project that was open source. Now, in the previous team, there was development of a project that is called Selenon. So if you are a Python developer and you would like to run task flows in a distributed system, Selenon offers that functionality for you. Again, you have YAML configuration file where you state how your YAML, your tasks should be executed, and they are executed in a cluster or in a distributed environment respecting that configuration. An example can be the following flow of tasks. So the flow is called by ingredients. You can see four tasks that are run. Three are run automatically. One is run conditionally if some condition is met. That condition can be a condition on some external event or availability of data and things like that. Tasks store data in a database and are executed respecting this configuration or this flow. This flow can be then grouped or called from another flow. So here you can see a larger flow that is calling that by ingredients flow. Okay, another project. JupyterLab requirements. So if you are a data scientist and you experiment with data in Jupyter notebooks, feel free to use JupyterLab requirements extension that is managing dependencies for you, and it automatically embeds dependencies into your notebook. So you do not end up with dependency issues and things like that. It automatically connects to the TOT resolver, so you get all the benefits from managing dependencies with that advanced resolution logic, but also it can default to other resolvers, specifically pipenv. And last project I have here is MicroPipenv. So again, if you're a Python developer and you're installing Python dependencies, you can benefit from using MicroPipenv. It's primarily designed for containerized Python applications, but it can be used also for installing applications on your local machine or wherever you want. The main benefit is that you have reproducible installations, unified installation logs, and it automatically consumes all the dependency formats for Python applications that are available out there. So it naturally integrates with poetry log files, pipenv log files, requirements, and also pip-tools specific requirements format. So if you are a Python developer, feel free to use it. And that way, I would like to thank you. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. So the question was, how's Red Hat after being acquired by IBM? So it stays as a separate entity within IBM, but we have cooperations with IBM. So for example, our team is cooperating with IBM Research, and some projects overlap, so we sync, but Red Hat stays as a separate entity. So the question was why I'm not using MacBook. I prefer ThinkPad. And yeah, I'm running it. Yeah, I think. Actually, you can ask for MacBooks. It's like standard distribution.
Those projects that you talked about, were they spin-offs from like internal needs, or do you guys have actually like a process where you look at the needs that are out there and you come up with things to fill up those needs, or how does it come up, the new projects?
So the question was how these new projects come up. So some of them come up as our needs. So our customers are, so we provide a platform to customers. And that means that we also use that platform. We know how that platform works. So if you are a developer at Red Hat and you work on OpenShift, you know how OpenShift works. And you know how you deploy applications on OpenShift. So that's like natural. That's how, for example, MicroPipenv was developed, because we wanted to deploy Python applications on OpenShift. But some are really like use cases from customer. The culture is very open. So if you say I will work on this and this is the value it will bring, like okay, you can do that. Any other question? Yeah. Red Hat Enterprise Linux. I use Fedora, and I don't have any problems. Mm-hmm. Any other question? Yeah. So if I understood the question correctly, the question is how Red Hat tackles communities and rights to push code?
Prioritize. What's gonna be the next feature?
Mm-hmm.
What's gonna go out?
So what will be the next feature? I would say it highly depends on a project. So if you take a look at, for example, Kubernetes, I think the most contributions are coming from Red Hat. But Kubernetes itself is used by other companies, and there are rights to push to specific parts of Kubernetes. So if somebody is holding networking subsystem of Kubernetes, then there are specific people that have the domain knowledge of networking, and then they are hired by companies like Red Hat for that knowledge and that rights. And also that's why Red Hat pays these people. Yes, so Red Hat sells support, and that's more sales question, I would say. So if you are a customer, then there are specifics to that customer, like we treat customers when it comes to offerings and what is, because every customer has some own, say, requirements from the application or that is sold by Red Hat. Okay, any other question? If not, thank you.